Good morning everyone. This is class 12 subject chemistry chapter 5 lecture number 2. As in lecture number 1, we had discussed the methods for the concentration of ore. Now in this lecture, I will be discussing extraction of crude metal from oxide, thermodynamic principles of metallurgy, then Allingham diagram, and after that we will do the application of Allingham diagram, that is extraction of iron from its oxide. So let's start with our first topic, that is extraction of crude metal from oxide. So now we will extract crude metal from concentrated ore because the metal in concentrated ore is still present in combined form. So the next step is extraction of crude metal from concentrated ore. In this we have two steps. First is conversion of concentrated ore to its oxide, and second is reduction of that oxide to metal. Now first of all we will start with conversion of concentrated ore to its oxide. Now in this step we have two processes, calcination and roasting. So one by one we will discuss these two methods. So calcination is heating the concentrated ore strongly in the limited supply of air or in the absence of air. And what will happen when we heat the concentrated ore, if the concentrated ore contains water. So when we heat, water is removed if we have hydrated oxide or hydrated ores. Next is moisture is removed, and this calcination method is commonly used to convert metal carbonates and metal hydroxides to their respective oxides. For example, we have metal carbonate, this is the calcium carbonate. Now when we heat this calcium carbonate, what will happen? It will convert to calcium oxide and CO2 gas will release. Similarly, this is the oxide of iron and this contains water molecules. So what will happen when we heat this oxide of iron, that is hydrated oxide of iron, what will happen? It will convert to its oxide and water molecule will remove. Similarly, we have the example of zinc carbonate. When we heat zinc carbonate, what will happen? It will convert to zinc oxide and again CO2 gas will release. So this is the method by which we can convert our metal carbonates and hydroxide or hydrated ores to its oxide. Now next is roasting. Roasting is again the heating of concentrated ore in the regular supply of air, or you can say that in the excess of air, at a temperature below the melting point of the metal. Because as concentrated ore also contains our desired metal, so we will heat the ore up to only that point where the metal, the desired metal, that does not melt. And similarly in this case, when we heat the concentrated ore, moisture is removed, and this method is used to remove impurities like sulfur, phosphorus or arsenic. That is, in concentrated ore, if we have the impurities of sulfur, phosphorus or arsenic, then this method helps in removing these type of impurities. For example, this is the ore of sulfide, zinc sulfide. When we heat in presence of oxygen, what will happen? The sulfide, it will convert to its respective oxide and SO2 gas will release. Similarly, this is lead sulfide. Now when we heat in the presence of air, what will happen? It will convert to lead oxide and the sulfur dioxide will escape out. Now this SO2, it is used in the manufacture of sulfuric acid. So these are the two methods in conversion of concentrated ore to metal oxide, that is calcination and roasting. By these methods, we can convert our concentrated ore to respective oxides. But sometimes what happened is the calcined or the roasted ore still contains some impurities. So an additional substance that is known as flux, that is added to the calcined or the roasted ore. So what is flux? Flux is a substance that chemically combines with the gangue, that is impurities, which may still present in calcined or roasted form. And what will happen, this flux, it will combine with the impurities to form a easily fusible material called slag. That is flux, third substance which we are adding to our calcined or roasted ore, plus gangue, which is impurities present in our concentrated ore after calcination or roasting. So flux plus gangue, it will form slag. Now this slag, it is insoluble in molten metal, and The slag is lighter in weight, therefore it floats over the surface of molten metal. That is, the slag, it will float over the surface of molten metal from where it can be skimmed off from time to time. Now we have two type of flux, acidic flux and basic flux. So first of all, what is acidic flux? Now if we have basic impurities, at that time we will use acidic flux. Basic impurities like calcium oxide, iron oxide, these are the basic impurities. So for removing these type of impurities, we will use acidic flux. Example of acidic flux is silica and borax. Now what will happen? These are our basic impurities and this is our acidic flux. So this basic impurity plus flux will give you slag, that is FeSiO3. Similarly, if we have CaO, impurities of calcium oxide, then the silica acidic flux, it will combine to give the slag of calcium. Similarly, if we have acidic impurities, then we will add basic flux to it. Acidic impurities like silica or the impurities of phosphorus. So what will happen? We will add basic flux. Example of basic flux is calcium carbonate. So what will happen? Again, flux plus these impurities, they will give slag. That is, this is our acidic impurities and this is our basic flux. So impurity plus flux will give you slag. So when in the calcined or roasted ore still some impurities are left, then we can remove those impurities by adding these flux, either acidic flux or basic flux, depending upon the impurities, that the impurities are acidic in nature or basic in nature. So next step is reduction of metal oxide to the metal. Now the reduction of metal oxide usually involves heating it with some other substance acting as a reducing agent. The reducing agent combines with the oxygen of the metal oxide. So this is our metal oxide and suppose this is our reducing agent. So what will happen when we reduce the metal oxide to metal? What will happen? This metal oxide will reduce to the metal and this reducing agent, it will combine with the oxygen. So the process of extracting the metals by heating the metal oxide with suitable reducing agent, that is known as pyrometallurgy and it is also known as thermal reduction. And if we choose carbon or carbon monoxide as a reducing agent, that process is known as smelting. That is, smelting is the reduction of metal oxide using carbon or carbon monoxide as a reducing agent, that is smelting. Now some metal oxide get reduced easily while others are very difficult to be reduced. In any case, heating is required to understand the variation in the temperature requirement for the thermal reductions and to predict which element will suit as the reducing agent for a given metal oxide, Gibbs energy interpretations are made. So next topic is thermodynamic principles of metallurgy. Now for any process, Gibbs free energy change is given by the equation, that is delta G equals to delta H minus T delta S, where delta G is Gibbs free energy change, delta H is enthalpy change, delta S is entropy change and T is temperature. And this delta G is also related to equilibrium constant, that is the relation is given by delta G equals to minus RT ln K, where delta G is Gibbs free energy change, R is gas constant, T is temperature and K is equilibrium constant. Now if the value of delta G is negative, then K will be positive. It means that the reaction will proceed in forward direction and the reactant will convert to product. From these facts, we can make the following conclusions. So there are two conclusions. First is the criteria of feasibility of a reaction at any temperature is that delta G of the reaction must be negative. That is, for a reaction to be spontaneous or for a reaction to be feasible, the criteria is that delta G of the reaction must be negative. Otherwise, that reaction will not be feasible. Second is a reaction with delta G positive can still be made to occur by coupling it with another reaction having larger negative delta G, so that the net delta G of the two reactions is negative. For example, if we have a reaction whose delta G value is positive, and if we combine that reaction with some another reaction for which the value of delta G is more negative, that is, when we combine these two reactions or when we couple those two reactions, the overall delta G value comes out to be negative. Therefore, such coupling reaction can be easily understood in terms of Ellingham diagram. So next is Ellingham diagram. Ellingham diagram normally consists of plots of standard free energy of formation of oxide as a function of temperature, that is graphical representation of Gibbs free energy of formation of oxide versus temperature. And this Ellingham diagram helps in predicting the feasibility of thermal reduction of an ore, that is how to convert or how to do the reduction of metal oxide into metal, that we can understand with the help of this Ellingham diagram. Now let us study the delta G during the formation of metal oxide, that is metal which is in solid state combines with dioxygen and metal oxide is formed, that is solid in nature. Now what happened during this reaction? Entropy will decrease because here we have solid state of metal oxide, that is delta S will become negative when the metal oxide is formed. Now this is the Ellingham diagram. On y-axis we have delta G for metal oxide and on x-axis we have temperature. So the plot of delta G formation versus temperature, that is known as Ellingham diagram. Now in Ellingham diagram we have three types of line. One type of line which is parallel to this temperature axis, one type of line which is going in upward direction, and one type of line which is going in downward direction. There are number of lines, or you can say there are number of metal oxides for which lines are drawn in your Ellingham diagram. Now what happened? Why some lines are going in downward direction and why some lines are going in upward direction? We will explain this with the example. First is this carbon solid combines with oxygen and CO2 is formed. Now this carbon, it is present in solid state, and this O2, it is present in gaseous form, and the CO2 is again a gas. Now if we want to calculate delta S, that is entropy, that is given by number of product of gaseous molecules minus number of gaseous molecules of reactant. Now on right hand side we have 1 mole of CO2, that is 1 mole of gas molecule CO2, and on left hand side we have also 1, that is O2. Now 1 minus 1, that is delta S will become 0. Now if we put the value of delta S in Gibbs equation, that is delta G equals to delta H minus T delta S. If the value of delta S will become 0, what will happen? This delta G will becomes to delta H, and this delta G is independent of temperature. That is why this line is parallel to temperature axis. It means that this line is independent of temperature. Now second case is, now we are considering this line which is going in downward direction. Now the example is, here we have 2 carbon plus oxygen is giving 2 carbon monoxide. Now if we want to calculate the delta S, again it is number of product of gaseous molecules minus number of reactant molecules, gaseous molecules. Now if we calculate the delta S, then it comes out to be 2, and on left hand side we have 1. So 2 minus 1 is 1, that means delta S is positive in this case. Now if we put the value of delta S in again this equation, that is delta G equals to delta H minus T delta S. Now what will happen? This delta S comes out to be positive. Now if we compare this equation with the equation of straight line, Y equals to mx plus c, so this delta S is the slope. So in this case when we put the value of delta S equals to positive, what will happen? The slope is negative. That is why this line is going in downward direction. Third case is, now this line which is going in upward direction, if we calculate the value of delta S, now in this case the value of delta S comes out to be negative. That is, on right hand side we have 2 moles of gas and on left hand side we have 3 moles of gas. So 2 minus 3 is minus 1, that is delta S is negative. So when again we put this value of delta S in this equation, that is delta G equals to delta H minus T delta S, then this equation will become, as in this case the value of delta S is negative. So what will happen? Delta G equals to delta H plus T delta S. Now in this case the value of slope is positive. That is why this line is going in upward direction. So in Ellingham diagram we have 3 types of line. One which is parallel to x-axis, that is temperature axis. It means it is independent of temperature. One type of lines which are going in downward direction. For those the value of slope is positive. For those the value of slope is negative and the value of delta S is positive. And the one type of line which is going in upward direction, for those lines the value of delta S is negative and the value of slope that is positive. So in Ellingham diagram we have 3 types of line. Now these lines are straight. The change will occur only when there is some change in entropy, or you can say when there is some change in the state of the substance. For example, if we consider this line, so this point around 673 Kelvin, this line, it goes upward. So this is the point where there is some changes in its state. That is why there is abrupt change in the slope. So these are the types of line in Ellingham diagram. Now during the reduction of oxide, what will happen? The metal oxide, it will reduce to metal and it will lose oxygen, whereas the reducing agent which we are using, that will accept oxygen and oxide of that reducing agent will form. So if we reverse the equation number 1, that is if we reverse the reduction reaction, what will happen? It will become metal plus oxygen is giving metal oxide. That is, the formation of oxide of metal will takes place, and for that delta G formation of oxide, it can be taken from Ellingham diagram. Now here the role of reducing agent is to provide a large negative delta G to make the sum of the delta G of the above two reactions negative. That is, when we couple these two reactions, oxidation and reduction, so the overall delta G for the reaction comes out to be negative, and we can say that the reaction is feasible, or the reduction of that metal oxide is feasible. Now if we consider the oxidation reaction, this is partial oxidation reaction. Now if we consider the complete oxidation, so what will happen? This carbon, it will combine with oxygen and it will give carbon dioxide. Now here we have delta G formation of oxide, that is from carbon to carbon dioxide, and in this case we have carbon to carbon monoxide. Similarly, if instead of carbon we are using carbon monoxide as a reducing agent, so what will happen? This carbon monoxide, it will combine with oxygen and we are getting carbon dioxide. So here we have delta G formation for carbon monoxide to carbon dioxide. Now if we subtract equation number 2 from equation number 5, we are getting metal oxide plus carbon is giving metal plus carbon monoxide. Similarly, when we subtract equation number 5 from equation number 3, then again we are getting metal oxide plus carbon is giving metal plus carbon dioxide. Now how we can say that reduction of metal oxides will takes place? Now this can be calculated by subtracting the delta G formation of these oxides, and if the delta G of the reaction comes out to be negative, only then we can say that the reduction of metal oxide to metal takes place, otherwise not. So alternatively, without doing delta G calculation for the reaction, we can still predict the feasibility of a reduction process simply looking at the Ellingham diagram. Now here we have 2 lines, one is for magnesium oxide and other is for aluminium oxide. Now how we can say that magnesium can reduce aluminium oxide or not, and aluminium can reduce magnesium oxide or not? So in simple way we can say that at any given temperature, any element or metal will reduce the oxide of other metal which lie above it in Ellingham diagram. Means the line which lie in the lower part, that will reduce the upper line. Here the magnesium line is lower and the aluminium line is above. So when we couple these two reactions, what will happen? The delta G comes out to be negative, and the delta G for the formation of magnesium oxide is much more negative. It means that the conversion of magnesium to magnesium oxide is more favorable. So here we can say that below the 1623 Kelvin temperature, magnesium, it can reduce aluminium oxide. But above 1623 Kelvin, what will happen? The magnesium line, it will go above this aluminium line. So we can say that above 1623 Kelvin, the aluminium can reduce magnesium oxide, whereas the magnesium, it cannot reduce aluminium oxide. So from here we can say that at any given temperature, any element, that is metal, will reduce the oxide of other metal which lie above it in Ellingham diagram. Means the line which lie lowers in the Ellingham diagram, that can be used for the reduction of the above lines. Whereas the reverse is not true. Means if we compare the line of aluminium and magnesium in this Ellingham diagram, so what we can say that below 1623 Kelvin, the magnesium line is lower, so it can reduce the aluminium oxide. But after 1623 Kelvin, what will happen? The line of magnesium will go higher and the line of aluminium, it is lower. That is, it lies lower than magnesium line. So we can say that above 1623 Kelvin, this magnesium cannot reduce aluminium, whereas aluminium can be used for the reduction of magnesium oxide after 1623 Kelvin. So this is all about Ellingham diagram. Now we will do the application of Ellingham diagram. That is, first is extraction of iron from its oxides. So first application of Ellingham diagram is extraction of iron from its oxide. Now there are so many ores of iron, but we will extract the iron from these ores. Now first step is crushing of the ore. So first step is conversion of these ore into powdered form. Next step is concentration of ore. So this can be done by hydraulic washing, and if the sulfide is present as impurity, so we can remove by froth flotation method. After that, third is calcination, that is conversion of the, that is conversion to oxide. And when we do calcination, water will be removed if any traces of water is present, and if any carbonate is present. So for the decomposition of carbonate, we will do calcination, and if sulfide is present, then we will do roasting. So after calcination and roasting, we will place our ore along with limestone and coke in the blast furnace. So in the blast furnace, the oxide is reduced to the metal. So thermodynamic helps us to understand how the coke reduces the metal oxide and why this furnace is chosen. One of the main reduction step in this process is this reaction, that is FeO plus carbon is giving Fe either in solid form or in liquid form plus this carbon monoxide. That is, it can be seen that this reaction, it is coupling of two simpler reaction. First is reduction of metal oxide to metal, and if this carbon is used as a reducing agent, so it will accept this oxygen. So when we calculate the delta G for this reaction, what will happen? This delta G for this reaction is delta G for carbon to carbon monoxide and delta G for iron oxide to iron. Now the next thing is how we will choose the reducing agent for the reduction of FeO to Fe. So this is the Ellingham diagram. Now this is the line for the formation of iron oxide, that is Fe plus O2 is giving FeO. Now this line, the line which is going in upward direction, this is carbon monoxide plus oxygen is giving carbon dioxide, and the line which is coming in downward direction, that is carbon plus oxygen is giving carbon monoxide. Now below this 1073 Kelvin, the line of CO to CO2, is lower as compared to the line of Fe to Fu. It means that below 1073 Kelvin, we can use CO as a reducing agent, that is the CO, it will reduce the FeO to Fe. Whereas above 1073 Kelvin, what will happen? The line of carbon to carbon monoxide is lower and the line of iron to iron oxide is higher. So above 1073 Kelvin, we can use this carbon as a reducing agent for the reduction of iron oxide to iron. So below 1073 Kelvin, CO reduces the oxides of iron, that is this line. This line reduces the oxides of iron. Above 1073 Kelvin, this line, this will reduce the oxides of iron, that is this will behave as the reducing agent. So there are reactions taking place in the furnace. So first is zone of combustion. So in zone of combustion, now what will happen, the temperature is 2170 Kelvin, that is the temperature in zone of combustion is 2170 Kelvin. What happens in this zone of combustion, carbon, it will combine with oxygen and form carbon dioxide. Now this reaction is exothermic, highly exothermic, that is why the temperature in this zone is high. Now next is zone of heat absorption. Now what will happen, the carbon dioxide which is formed in zone of combustion, it will combine with carbon and carbon monoxide will form. Now this step, in this step heat is absorbed, that is why the temperature in this zone is lower as compared to zone of combustion. Now third is zone of slag formation. As we introduced limestone along with ore, so what will happen, the calcium carbonate, it will convert to calcium oxide plus carbon dioxide. Now if any amount of silica is present in the ore, so what will happen, this is acidic in nature and the CaO, it is basic impurity, so what will happen, it will act as a flux. So basic impurity plus flux, what will happen, there will be formation of slag. So in zone of slag formation, slag will form. Now fourth is zone of reduction. Now here what will happen, in the blast furnace below 1073 Kelvin, so when the temperature is below 1073 Kelvin, the carbon monoxide, it will reduce iron oxide, and above 1073 Kelvin, the coke, carbon will reduce FeO to Fe. So these are the reaction taking place in the furnace. Next is zone of fusion. Now this is the lower part of the furnace. Temperature here is between 1423 to 1673 Kelvin. Now in this region, the spongy iron melts and dissolves some carbon, sulfur or phosphorus. And in this range, the silicate which is formed by calcium oxide and silica also melt in this region. Both the molten slag and the molten iron trickle down into earth where they can form two separate layers. Now slag being lighter in weight floats over the iron, and from here we can collect both the liquids separately. And the iron thus obtained from the furnace contain about 4% of carbon and many impurities like sulfur, phosphorus or silicon in small amount, and this iron is known as pig iron. Now when we melt pig iron with scrap of iron and coke using hot air blast, so in this way we can remove 1% of the impurity, that is 3% of the impurities will still remain, and that iron is known as cast iron. The third form is wrought iron, which is the purest form of iron. This can be obtained by cast iron by oxidizing the impurity in a reverberatory furnace lined with hematite. What will happen? The hematite oxidizes carbon to carbon monoxide, and the limestone is added as a flux, and sulfur, silicon and phosphorus are oxidized and passed into the slag. The metal is removed and freed from the slag by passing through rollers. So in this way we can convert our cast iron into wrought iron, which is the pure form of iron. So this zone is zone of combustion, where carbon combines with oxygen and CO2 will form. Here the
high amount of energy is released because this process is exothermic, that is why the temperature is very high. Now in this range, this is the zone of heat absorption, because in this range the carbon dioxide which is formed will combine with carbon and carbon monoxide will form. Next is zone of slag formation. This is the zone of slag formation where the CaO, calcium oxide, react with silica and slag will form. Now fourth zone is zone of reduction. Now here the temperature is 1070, so when the temperature is below 1073, at that time CO will reduce iron oxide, and above 1073 coke will reduce iron oxide to iron. Now this is the zone of fusion, and here we have molten slag and molten iron. So from here we can collect our molten iron and molten slag separately. So again I am repeating that when we obtain the iron from blast furnace, that iron is pig iron which contains 4% of carbon and many impurities in small amount. When we melt pig iron with scrap iron and coke, then that iron is cast iron and that contains 3% impurities. And when along with cast iron we add hematite and coke, then we will convert cast iron into the purest form of iron, that is wrought iron. So this is one of the application of Ellingham diagram, that is the extraction of iron from its oxide. So after doing this, you can solve NCERT exercise question number 5, 7, 14, 15, question number 20, 21, 22, 23 and question number 27. Now I will be discussing the homework that I gave you in lecture number 1. First question is, what is the role of depressant in the froth flotation process? So the answer for this question is that if we want to concentrate two sulfide ores, then we add a third substance which is known as depressant. For example, if we have lead sulfide and zinc sulfide and we want to concentrate these two ores, so a third substance, that is sodium cyanide, will add, and this sodium cyanide will act as a depressant. That is, it allows lead sulfide to form froth, whereas it prevents zinc sulfide to form froth by forming a complex. Next question is question number 13. How can you separate alumina from silica in bauxite ore associated with silica? So the answer for this question is, this can be done by leaching method. So third question is minerals and ores. So minerals are the naturally occurring chemical substances in the form of which metal occur in earth crust. Those are minerals, and the mineral from which metal is conveniently and economically extracted is called ore. Next question is, how is leaching carried out in the case of low grade copper ores? So leaching in case of low grade copper ores can be done with acids in the presence of air. So these are the four questions which I gave you in lecture number 1. Thank you so much and have a nice day.